Man, you guys are greeting better this week. Last week, you guys kind of like, hey, and then just took your seat. And it was awkward. And so this is better. Just rip it off. Go say hey, right? Come on. How many of you guys come in here excited to see the rest of the body of Christ gathered here with us? Yes, I love it. Like, it's my favorite thing. I will admit I'm an extrovert, and so that's a thing. And I get that some of you are introverts. How many of you guys, by show of hands, are introverts in here, you would say? Okay, awesome, perfect. So there's a quiet little closet in the back there you guys can use whenever you feel uncomfortable. It's fine. But no, we're excited to come into the house of God, to be his people. And so we are in a series called The What? The Chosen. What are we talking about? Bam. Yes. These conversations that Jesus has had with us, right, that we get to read about in Scripture. And it's just, I don't know, does it ever, the obvious things get me sometimes, guys. I'll be honest. I don't know. I can be really ADD. And so the obvious things that stand out to me, man, just the fact that Jesus speaks to people like they're having one-on-one conversations with Jesus. Come on. I don't know, like that, I just thought about that this week. You know, there's people who you would love to have a conversation with. Just shout out a name of somebody you'd like to have a conversation, a one-on-one with. Who's this? Yourself? Okay, Danny's an introvert, so he's all, yeah, just me. He just raised his hand, is all he did, yeah. But we have people, right, that we want to have a conversation with, and then Jesus has conversations with us. Think about that. That's unbelievable. It's breathtaking. And so we're going to read a story about a guy who gets to have a conversation with Jesus that spills over into our reality today, right? With truth about who God is and what he's done that just will blow our minds. And so I'm not going to give you a whole lot of preamble into it. I want to read the story and then I want to pray and ask God to speak because that's what we're asking for today. Yes. You all don't need my words. You came here to hear Jesus's words. Amen. And so I want to read this to you, and then I want us to lean into this text today. This is John chapter 1, verse 43, and I believe this is page 825. 834. I was so close. You guys would be looking forever. You'd be in Matthew. Awesome. So here we go. Verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. Do you notice Jesus decides things, church? There you go. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Think about those words. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" And Jesus answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and angels of God descending and ascending on the Son of Man." The word of the Lord. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I'm asking today that we see heaven opened. God, would you pull open the veil? Would you reveal to us who you are? Would we see your presence in the Son, Jesus Christ, who is with us now through the Spirit of God, I pray. Lord, I'm asking that you would do your work in our heart. God, we're here to worship. We're here to bow down. We're here to say that you are my God, that you have the reins, that you're in control, that you are doing what you are doing in our lives, and we submit to it, we surrender to it with joy in our hearts because we want you, Jesus. And so I ask for you to do that work in us today. Would you help us understand your word? Would you speak in your powerful voice to us this conversation? I ask in Jesus' name, amen? Awesome. All right, verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, what? Follow me. Exactly. Notice that Jesus found Philip. Do you guys see that? Come on, say it with me. Jesus
found Philip.
Okay, you're going to hear that word like a gajillion times in this text, okay? I'm not exaggerating, all right? I do say things exaggeratively sometimes. But you're going to see the word found. You're going to see the word see. You're going to see the word new in this text numerous times. Now, let me ask you something, church. When you see words many times, what does it mean? They're important, yes, right? The author, John, of this text is giving us something that's significantly important that we get to see and we get to know and we get to hear today. And so I want to just out of the gate, just take your mind and focus on the reality of what God is doing. Jesus found Philip and said to him, "Follow me, follow me." Now, this is Philip's call to discipleship, right? Philip's this dude, he's living his life, doing his thing, and he comes in contact with Jesus, yes? How many guys were that guy? You're just doing your thing, right? You're living your life. Yeah, John's nodding over here, like, right? And you're going about your business, yes, and all of a sudden, Jesus finds you. What happened to anybody in this room today? And what happens to you? Your whole world gets destroyed, does it not? Like, it's this massive change that goes on. He goes, "Follow me," and Philip goes, "Okay," and leaves everything behind, the city he's from, the family he knew, the things he had, and he goes and he follows Jesus. And this following of Jesus is discipleship. He is going to learn from Jesus. He's gonna literally walk the roads with Jesus. He's gonna sleep on the ground next to Jesus. He's gonna have this relationship with the God of the universe in the flesh because Jesus said these words to him, "Follow me." It's beautiful. And here at Highland, we say disciples, which is what Philip is. Disciples love Jesus. You guys agree with that? They love Jesus. Guess what Philip learned to do? He learned to love Jesus, yes? Disciples live for Jesus. You guys agree with that? Your life all of a sudden has changed. I'm not living for me anymore. I'm living for the kingdom of God. I'm living for what Jesus is doing on the world. And disciples also lead others to Jesus. Yes? And that's exactly what we see what Philip does here. Verse 44. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Where was Jesus going? He was going to Galilee. Where's Bethsaida? It doesn't matter. It's not Galilee, right? He's left his home. He's going, verse 45. And listen to what it says. Philip found, there's that word. Who'd Philip find? Nathanael. And said to him, listen to these words. "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." There's our word. You see that word in those two verses, find and found. Philip finds Nathanael to tell him this news, that we have found Jesus. Now, we're going to see that this point clearly further on, we're going to see this thing developed. But remember, Jesus found Philip. Yes? Stay with me on the logic. Jesus found Philip. Philip found Nathanael. The disciples found Jesus. You with me so far? Let's keep going here. I can tell we're right with me here. So Philip tells Nathanael that Jesus is the one who the law and the prophets spoke about. When he's saying that to Nathanael, what's he telling him? He's saying that all the Old Testament speaks about this one man, Jesus, all right? Moses, what he wrote in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, those five books, guess what he was writing about? He's writing about Jesus, right? The prophets who spoke, guess who they're writing about? Jesus. And so unless we interpret the Old Testament through the lens of Jesus, guess what we do? We interpret it wrongly. Right? Luke 24:44, Jesus says, then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about Jesus. Me, Jesus, in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." You're right though. It's a hymn, but it's right. It's Jesus, right? Further in John 5:39, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life." Who's he talking to? He's talking to the Pharisees, the guys who search the scriptures. And he says, "And it is they that bear witness about who?"
Jesus.
Me. But it's Jesus, yes? The Old Testament reveals Jesus. This is the theme of the Old Testament in shadows, in types, in prophecies, in visions, in Christophanies, which is an appearance of Christ before he was incarnate, coming on earth to save his people. It's what the Old Testament speaks about. And this text is making that very clear. We found him. the one we've been looking for, the one that we've been reading about since we were kids, memorizing Torah. We found the one who is to come, and his name is Jesus, and he comes from Nazareth, and he's the son of Joseph. Now, that doesn't strike you as funny or significant, does it? Nazareth. How many of you guys are from Nazareth in here? That doesn't matter either, because it's not about you. It's about Jesus. But here, verse 46, Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip said to him, what? "Come and see." Can anything good come out of Nazareth? I want to point out to you that in this culture, many of the people who would hear this from Jesus or would hear this from another disciple or someone sharing their witness would say, we're going to reject the idea that the prophets and the law speak about Jesus. We're looking for another one. We're looking for somebody else. We're going to stop there. But Nathanael doesn't do that, does he? He just simply objects to the fact that Jesus comes from Nazareth. And so I want to describe what Nazareth is to you. Nazareth equals Nowhereville. All right. How many of you guys came from Nowhereville before? Yeah, you're here in Cody. Some of you think that this is Nowhereville. But to some of you who've moved here, this is Somewhereville, right? It's the place to be. But Nazareth was Nowhereville. In fact, it means out of nowhere. Yeah, right? Some of y'all from Powell, you're like, I get that. I get that. I'm just kidding. We love Powell. Just not your football team. Out of nowhere, right? Nazareth was a nothing town. It was not special. It was not significant. It was utterly unexpected. But the Old Testament expectation was that Messiah would be, in a sense, unexpected. Do you guys know that? As much as it's teaching about Jesus, he's going to be unexpected and he's going to be from nowhere. Look at this. Isaiah prophesied in Isaiah 53:2. "For he," speaking of Jesus, "grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground." Listen to this. "He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him." How many of you guys have seen the classic blonde hair, blue-eyed picture of Jesus? Yes? It's wrong, okay? That's not what Jesus looked like. Jesus, in fact, was probably very well not attractive. He's not the guy you expect to come be the king of the world, the leader. David's described as being handsome and ruddy. How many of you men here have been described like that before, huh? Right? David would bring up the group average. They're saying Jesus would actually bring it down. He wasn't expected. See, they weren't looking for this kind of leader. They had in their mind another kind. They had in their mind somebody different, somebody else, someone who was going to be whimsical and attractive and awesome, someone who they could describe and say, that's what a real man and a real leader looks like. They didn't expect Jesus to come. And that the description, this description of Isaiah really doesn't sound like the Son of God or the King of Israel, does it? He had no form or majesty. Kings have majesty. "That we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him." Doesn't sound like the Son of God, does it? But here's the thing about Nowhereville. While unexpected, that's exactly what was expected from the Messiah. See, Nazareth comes from the Hebrew word netzer. Everybody say that with me, netzer. You can call your mom and tell her you learned Hebrew today, and she's gonna be proud of you because you did that, netzer. Netzer means branch. Branch. You're like, wow, okay, this is what I came here for today, right? What do we know about? Whoa. So I'll just settle down here for a moment. Get the Bible wet. What do we know about branches biblically? Isaiah 11, 1 through 5 says this. "There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots shall bear fruit." Jesse is King David's father. So when the word says from Jesse, he's talking about King David. So from David will come a branch that will bear fruit. What kind of fruit is this branch going to bear? Verse 2, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and his delight shall be in the fear of Yahweh. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide disputes by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Verse 5, righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. Verse 10, in that day the root of Jesse, who shall stand as a signal for all the peoples, of him shall the nations inquire, and his resting place shall be glorious. The one with no majesty, the one people aren't looking for, is the very one who the nations will come to. Amen? He's the very one whose resting place shall be glorious. It will be majestic. Praise God. Because he's the King of Kings. Out of the town named Branch was coming the branch who was the Savior of the world. Come on. Jesus, the branch, the root of Jesse, coming from the kingship, is coming to be the king of the world. Jesus is the branch that comes from the root of Jesse. He's the rightful heir of the throne of David. He is truly the king of Israel, as Nathanael is going to confess. And it comes from his hometown. Nothing. And what's beautiful about this is that to persuade Nathanael who Jesus is, he doesn't give him some massive argument, does he? How many of you guys, you think to win someone to Jesus, you have to have all the arguments mastered? Yes, you're all apologetics, they've got to be tight, right? Get out there and get it done. Listen, he doesn't say that to him. What's he say? Come and see. That's Philip's rebuttal. Come and see. This is the same phrase, by the way, that Jesus used earlier in John 1:38 when he was asked where he was staying by other disciples. He just said, come and see. Come and see. Philip didn't try to persuade Nathanael through argumentation. He didn't get him through his apologetic. He got him through the power of God to reveal truth. Come and see is an invitation to the reality of Christ at work in our lives. Come on. Church, I want to just ask this question right now before we move on. Do our lives reflect such a reality? Can you tell somebody, come and see what Jesus has done in my life? Is that your testimony? Because if not, if we can't invite somebody in to see Jesus, then there's something that's wrong there, yes? If my life doesn't reflect a transformed life by the power of the gospel, the power of Jesus Christ, then there's something that's off in my life. Where I started to where I am now, can you see a miracle that Jesus did in me? What God has worked, can you see in my life that I am known by Christ? When I invite you to look into my life, are you going to see Jesus? That's the question, church. Come and see. And this is what he's going to see. Check this out, verse 47. Oh man, Jesus, what's the word? Saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit. Can that be just said of you guys? Right? This is something very cool here, guys. We're gonna do some Old Testament work here because I want you not to miss this. Jesus calls Nathanael true Israelite. Nathanael is a descendant from Israel. Yes, you with me so far? Israel was the name of a man whose name was changed from what? From Jacob, right? God changes Jacob's name to Israel, and all his descendants from then are called Israel. Yes, they take his name, Israel. And here's what's fascinating. Jesus says to Nathanael that in you there is no deceit. Why is that significant? Because to understand this, you have to understand the Jewish history. Jacob means heel grabber. Any Jacobs in the room today? sweet name, heel grabber. Now you hear that and you're like, oh, you know, what does that mean? When Jacob and Esau were born, they were twins. Esau was born, followed by Jacob, who was said to be holding on to Esau's heel. Heel grabber is a Hebrew euphemism for a lying cheater. It's a euphemism for a deceiver. And if you know anything about Jacob's life, he is exactly that. He is a deceiver. On many occasions, he deceives and he cheats and he tricks people out of what is theirs to get ahead in his own life. This happens again and again and again and again. You read his, you guys read his story and you're just like, oh my gosh, this is whom the nations are gonna be blessed through, this dude, right? Like, what is this? Genesis 26, 27, Esau says of Jacob, is he not rightly named heel grabber? For he has cheated me these two times. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he has taken away my blessing. That's how low this guy is. He's taken everything from his brother whose it was rightfully belonged to. That's what Jacob does. He's deceitful. Throughout Jacob's life, he cheated his way to the top. He stole his brother's birthright for a bowl of stew. And he likewise stole his brother's blessing by imitating his brother. I mean, just shady. Jacob was deceitful, whereas Nathanael is described as having no deceit. See, Nathanael descends from a deceiver, yet without deception. Do you see that? This is a profound statement. Jesus sees the purity of Nathanael's heart. But here's what's amazing, guys. While Jacob lived years of his life as a deceiver, he had an encounter with the Lord that would change his life and it would change his name. Because that's what Jesus does. Jacob wrestles with God in Genesis 32. And in this story, he won't let go, right? He's trying to get something from the Lord. And he has a vision from God that transformed his character. See, Jacob saw the reality of who he was. God actually asks him, what's your name? What's your name? And he's not saying, hey, nice to meet you. He's going, what are you? And Jacob gets honest with him. And he says, my name is Jacob. What am I? I'm a deceiver. That's who I am. And in that encounter, when he tells God who he really is, he surrenders to the Lord. And guess what the Lord does? He gives him a new name. He says, no, Jacob, that's not who you are. That's who you were. Come on. And God gives him a new name, the name that is Israel. Israel means prince with God. That's who you are when God comes and wrestles with you, church. Come on. But here's the cool thing. Nathanael is an Israelite, not a Jacob. Right? Nathanael is someone who is honest, not deceitful, and Jesus sees that in him. Nathanael is Israel. The etymology of Israel is Israel. See it up here on the screen? Israel, there you go, which means the man who sees God. And Nathanael is about to see God. This is beautiful. Let's read on, verse 48. Nathanael said to him, how do you, what's he say? Know me. How do you know me? And Jesus answered him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Nathanael answered him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. How do you know me? Have you ever thought about this, church? Jesus knows you. Show of hands, yes? You thought about this? Jesus knows you. See, Nathanael is revealing that his heart has been penetrating by the all-power knowing of Jesus. Have you seen that? He goes, woo, Jesus just read my cards. He does this again and again, right? He does for the woman at the well. He knows everything about her. He knows her and he sees her and he does that with Nathanael. He understands. And Nathanael is recognizing the reality that he is exposed in the light of Jesus Christ, that there's something completely different. How many of you guys have had that experience? You've been exposed in the light of Jesus Christ, and it is powerful. Jesus knows you. It's not just that he knows that you exist or that he knows about you. He knows you. I know that that sounds so obvious, but sometimes the obvious needs to penetrate our reality, right? Jesus is not looking out, seeing the mass of people. Guys, he's talking to one man, and he's saying, I know you. He sees your heart. He understands your thoughts. He knows what you're going to do before you even do it. Man. And Nathanael responds by declaring exactly who Jesus is, doesn't he? See, Nathanael reveals that he knows who Jesus is too. And so I want to ask you this morning, do you know who Jesus is? Because see, when Jesus knows us, when he comes in and reveals that to us, the response to him is knowing who he is. See, Nathanael goes on to describe the identity of Jesus. He says, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel, right? That's who you are. You came from Know Nothing Tam. You're the branch. You're the one we're looking for, right? You're the King, and you are the Son of God. He responds in faith. Guys, listen, when we are known by Jesus, we are known by Jesus before we ever know him for ourselves. Think about that. Jesus saw him coming before he ever saw Jesus. Jesus saw him when he's underneath the fig tree before he ever sees Jesus. Jesus sees him, Jesus knows him, and he comes to faith in Jesus. What did Jesus know within Nathanael? The text says that when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Now, where in your Bible can you find the story of Nathanael sitting under the fig tree? Show of hands. Nowhere. It doesn't exist. That story's not in there, right? So Jesus, in his wisdom, thought, we don't need to write that one down. We're not going to tell you what happened with that. So we don't know if he was literally sitting under a fig tree. We don't know what that means, what happened to Nathanael. Text just doesn't tell us that. However, this expression is also a Hebrew euphemism. When a rabbi would study with pure motives that were resolute in seeking God, it was said that he would study under a vine or under a fig tree. This is a heart of no deceit. Studying to find the Savior. This was a picture of their seriousness and wanting to understand the things of God. And Jesus is saying, I see that in you, Nathanael. But it went further. See, when it says that they studied under the fig tree, it reflected their expectation of God's action in history. Nathanael was looking for the Messiah. He's one of the ones who's not looking at the Old Testament going like, man, I don't see where he's going to come. I'm not seeing it. He's looking for him. Guess what he recognized? The reason I think Nathanael doesn't go back and say the Old Testament and the prophets, Moses and the prophets don't speak about Jesus, because guess what? He knew. It'd been revealed. He's seeking and he's searching for God, and he's doing it with a purity in his heart. He is not deceitful. He is true, and he is looking for Jesus, and he expects the Messiah to show up. Come on. He's got an expectant heart, and that heart, Jesus said, I saw you. Man, how many of you guys have gone through life just feeling like nobody sees you? I want to just get vulnerable here right now, right? You've been invited to things and your opinion's not really mattered, and you kind of are the one who's just always on the outside of the conversation. And you go, you know, I want people to understand what I'm thinking here, what I'm doing, but I just don't feel like anybody sees me, right? Maybe you're in a relationship and you're like, man, my spouse doesn't see me. Men, open your eyes up, okay? Like, come on. People want to be seen. They want to be heard. They want to be known. And the reality is that Jesus sees you. He sees everything you're going through. He sees your struggle, your triumph, and your pain. And when Jesus says to Nathanael that I see you, it was a miracle that led him to faith. Philip's invitation to Nathanael was to come and see. And what Nathanael saw was that Jesus saw him first. Come on. Before Philip invited Nathanael to Christ, Christ saw Nathanael, truly saw him. Church, Christ is the one who found Nathanael. Christ is not lost. Come on. God is not lost and in need of us to find him. It says that we are lost and in need of being found by him. Amen. And that's exactly what Jesus does. After seeing this, Nathanael responds in faith. And Jesus says, verse 50, Jesus answered him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe?" What's he say? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, "Truly, truly," that's the most true thing Jesus can say. He says, "I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." I want you to think about these phrases with me. You will see heaven opened. Can you think of a moment in your Bible where you see the story where it says that you see heaven opened? Can you think with me? The baptism of Jesus Christ. Says this, Matthew 3, verse 16. "And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up out of the water, and behold," what's it say? "The heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him." What Isaiah say? That the Spirit of God would rest on him. "And behold, a voice from heaven saying this, 'This is my beloved Son, with who I am well pleased.'" See, along with the heavens opening comes the approval of God. Isn't that beautiful? And Nathanael, you're gonna see heaven opened and you're gonna see angels ascending and descending. Have you ever come across a place in scripture where it says angels are ascending and descending on something? Jacob. Yeah, Jacob. Jacob has this dream. Right before God changes his name, listen, Genesis 28, 12. And he dreamed, that's Jacob, "And behold, there was a ladder set up on the earth. And the top of it reached" where? "To heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, Yahweh stood above it and said, 'I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac.'" Verse 16, "Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, 'Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it.' And he was afraid and said, 'How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven.'" Jacob had a dream where he sees a ladder with the presence of God coming to fill the earth. I love Jacob's words because he says, "This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven." And Jacob goes on to name the place Bethel, for he says, "Surely the Lord is in this place." And church, let me tell you, Jacob's ladder represents God's plan to come to the earth and dwell with his people, that the presence of the Lord would be in this place. It's about God's presence coming among us. And Jesus said that Nathanael would see the angels ascending and descending on who? The Son of Man. Church, Jesus is the ladder to heaven. Come on. Jesus is giving him the gospel. Jesus is the very presence of God on earth. See, when Jesus says, "You're gonna see angels descending and ascending on me," he's saying, "Here is the presence of God with you." Man. Jesus is the gate. And he says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me," right? Jesus is revealing who he is in this conversation to Nathanael, one who'd been seeking, one who'd been looking for the Messiah. And Jesus says, "Listen, Nathanael, today, here I am. I have found you. I saw you. I know you. I made you. I have called you, and I have made you mine. And here I am with you, the presence of God here to dwell." And church, he's saying the same thing to you. Let's pray. I want you to reflect on some of this today. Because this isn't a story just about Nathanael and Jesus knowing him or seeing him. The question I think the Spirit would ask you today is, does Jesus know you? Has Jesus seen you? Some of you might have resonated with Jacob's story. You're like, man, today I just realized that I'm a deceiver. Like, I've lived my life in selfish pursuit and running after things and just taking what I want, living for my own self, doing it my own way. And maybe today the Lord has come down to wrestle with you, to give you a new name. And today's the day that you're saying, I'm responding in faith to that, that I believe in the power of Jesus Christ, that he is the ladder to heaven, that there is no way to the Father but by him. Have you sensed the powerful, soul-penetrating sight of the Spirit of God in your life this morning? If you have, then I want to tell you today that Jesus found you. You might have come here looking for something today, but I want to remind you, Jesus found you. And church, you know that Jesus has found you when you confess like Nathanael that Jesus is the Son of God, that he's the King of the world. And I want to ask you today, is he the King of your world? See, he's the rightful king to David's throne. He's the root of Jesse, the branch that bears fruit with the Spirit of God. But I'm asking, is he the king of your world? He's the king of the world, but is he the king of yours? See, some of you need to bow your kingship to his. See, this is the power of the gospel, that the Son of God, the King of Kings, knows you and sees you, and that he says he's for you and not against you. So, Father in heaven, we thank you that you loved us enough to send your Son, that you gave Jesus, the light of the world, to come to earth to find us. Lord, I pray that the reality of what you did for us would not just escape us this morning, but that we would truly see you. We would see the beauty of who you are, Jesus, of what you've done. God, that we would know you, Jesus, that we wouldn't come in here and just have a taste, but that we would know you more and more. God, I pray that the reality of what you did, Jesus, when you took that cross, would just hit our hearts all new today. That although there was nothing magnificent that we should desire you, you came anyway. Because Jesus, you desired to save. It's about your desire. So would you change ours, Lord? This moment, who you are, the Son of Man who came from a nowhere town, who is the Savior of the world. We look to you, the center of all history. We look to your cross, and we look to your resurrection. And we praise you this morning. Amen.